Ladies and gentlemen, good morning. I'm Cadet Second Lieutenant Ethan Adams. I'm the Master of Ceremonies for today. Welcome to today's ceremony and thank you for attending. At this time, we ask that you please silence all personal communication devices and that you show dignity and respect throughout our ceremony. I'm honored to be speaking with you today on such a great occasion. We are here today to pay tribute to our community service members past and present, and to recognize the sacrifices they have made to fulfill their obligation of duty, honor, and country. Today we will remember the courageous men and women that took a sacred oath to support and defend the Constitution of the United States against all enemies, foreign and domestic. Today we will remember those that wrote a blank check with their lives, never knowing if it will be cashed, and to remember those that stood for all that we are, answered our nation's call, and fought to protect our way of life. Ladies and gentlemen, please stand for the presentation and posting of the national colors, the playing of the national anthem, and we ask that you remain standing for the invocation. Today, the colors are being presented by Fairview's own Yellow Jacket Battalion Color Guard. The right color guard is Cadet Sergeant Victor Crowder. Carrying the national colors is Cadet Master Sergeant Erica Forrest. Carrying the Tennessee state colors is Cadet Corporal Kendra Johnson. Carrying the FVHS Junior ROTC colors is Cadet Private First Class Jacob Banker. The left color guard is Cadet Staff Sergeant Kaylee Hill. Our national anthem will be played by our own Fairview High School band. Please join us as our battalion chaplain, Cadet Sergeant First Class A.J. Garcia, leads us in the invocation.
Could you all please be quiet? Can you please bow your heads to him? Let us pray. Dear Lord, thank you for allowing us to come together today. Thank you for the brave men and women who have sacrificed so much to keep our country free and preserve our way of life. We're also grateful for the servicemen and women fighting right now overseas. As this assembly is taking place, we pray that you watch over them and protect them. We pray that you are with those families that have built ones and sacrificed their time, hearts, and even their lives, and that we are grateful for the freedoms that we have all been given. In your name we pray. Amen.
World War I, also known as the Great War, officially ended when the Treaty of Versailles was signed at the Palace of Versailles in France on June 28, 1919. However, fighting ceased 7 months earlier when an armistice, with temporary cessation of hostilities between the Allied nations and Germany, went into effect on the 11th hour of the 11th day of the 11th month. For that reason, November 11, 1918 is regarded the end of the war to end all wars. In November of 1919, President Wilson proclaimed November 11th as the first commemoration of Armistice Day with the following words. To us in America, the reflections of Armistice Day will be filled with solemn pride in the heroism of those who died in the country's service and with gratitude for the victory, both because of the thing from which it has freed us and because of the opportunity it has given America to show our sympathy with peace and justice in the councils of the nations. Armistice Day is a day meant for parades, public meetings, and a brief suspension of business beginning at 11 a.m. to celebrate the end of World War I. The United States Congress officially recognized the end of World War I when it passed a concurrent resolution on June 4, 1926 with these words. Whereas the 11th of November, 1918 marked the cessation of the most destructive, sanguinary, and far-reaching war in human annals and the resumption by the people of the United States of peaceful relations with other nations, which we hope may never again be severed. And whereas it is fitting that the recurring anniversary of this date should be commemorated with thanksgiving and prayer and exercises designed to perpetuate peace through goodwill and mutual understanding between nations. And whereas the legislatures of 27 of our states have already declared November 11th to be a legal holiday, therefore be it resolved by the Senate that the President of the United States is requested to issue a proclamation calling upon the officials to display the flag of the United States on all government buildings on November 11th, and inviting the people of the United States to observe the day in schools and churches or other suitable places, with appropriate ceremonies of friendly relations with all other peoples. On May 13, 1938, an act was ratified to make the 11th November in each year a legal holiday dedicated to the cause of world peace and be thereafter be celebrated as Armistice Day. At first, Armistice Day was a day set aside to honor veterans of World War I. But after World War II, it required the greatest mobilization of soldiers, sailors, Marines, and airmen in the nation's history of 1954. And after American forces had fought aggression in Korea, the 83rd Congress, at the urging of the veteran service organizations, amended the Act of 1938 by replacing the word armistice with the word veterans. With the approval of this legislation, Public Law 380, on June 1st, 1954, November 11th became a day to honor every American veteran from every war. On October 8th, that same year, President Dwight D. Eisenhower issued the first Veterans Day proclamation, which stated, "In order to ensure proper and widespread observance of this anniversary, all veterans organizations, and the entire citizenry will wish to join hands in the common purpose." The Uniform Holiday Bill was signed on June 28, 1968, and ensured 3-day weekends for federal employees by celebrating 4 national holidays on a Monday: Washington's Birthday, Memorial Day, Veterans Day, and Columbus Day. These extended weekends were supposed to encourage travel recreational, and cultural activities, as well as stimulate greater industrial and commercial production. However, many states continue to celebrate the holidays on their original dates. The first Veterans Day under the new law was observed with much confusion on October 25th, 1971. It was apparent that the commemoration of this day was a matter of historic and patriotic significance to a great number of our citizens. So on September 20th, 1975, President Gerald R. Ford signed Public Law 94-97, which returned the annual observance of Veterans Day to its original date of November 11, beginning in 1978. This action supported the desires of the overwhelming majority of state legislatures, all major veterans service organizations, and the American people. Veterans Day continues to be observed on November 11th, regardless of what day on the week of which it falls, which preserves the historical significance and focuses the attention on the important purpose of Veterans Day, a celebration to honor America's veterans for their patriotism, love of country, and willingness to serve and sacrifice for the common good. It is a day to recognize and remember all veterans past and present, those serving today, and those that have paid the ultimate price in defense of our country and our way of life. At this time, we would like to ask all of you that have served in the military, all of our veterans present here today, to please stand. Thank you for all you have done for us. Thank you for all you have sacrificed. Please be seated. Dr. Mike Looney has served as superintendent of Williamson County Schools since December of 2009. He earned his bachelor's degree in business management and master's degree in education from Jacksonville State University in Alabama. Dr. Laney earned his educational specialist degree and doctorate in educational leadership from the University of Alabama. Dr. Laney's work has been published in professional journals, and he has presented for regional and national audiences on a wide range of educational and leadership topics. He has served on several distinguished panels to include President George W. Bush's National Reading Leadership Panel in Washington, D.C. For 4 years prior to coming to Williamson County, Dr. Laney was superintendent of the Butler County School District in Alabama. Under his leadership, the school district realized significant student achievement gains, improved the graduation rate, and established the district's first magnet school. In recognition of his work there, he was selected as Greenville, Alabama Citizen of the Year in 2008. Before arriving at Butler, he served as Assistant Superintendent for Curriculum and Instruction in Montgomery Public Schools. Under his leadership, the district of 61 schools and 31,000 students received national notoriety for its improvement in reading achievement scores. Dr. Looney, a public educator since 1994, has also served in the roles of classroom teacher, assistant principal, and principal. During his tenure as principal, his school was recognized for closing the achievement gap for underprivileged and minority students. His school was highlighted at both the state and national levels and was named a National Title I Distinguished School. Prior to entering the field of education, he served as finance manager for a privately held corporation with 50 employees in Anniston, Alabama. His responsibilities included corporate finance, marketing, and human resource management. Dr. Looney is a military veteran, having served for 7 years in the United States Marine Corps before being honorably discharged with a service-related injury. His military service was distinguished by 4 meritorious promotions, which included his being selected as the Marine of the Year for MCRS Montgomery, serving Alabama, Mississippi, and Florida. In addition to other medals and ribbons, he was the recipient of the Navy and Marine Corps Achievement Medal. His military duties took him all over the world and included the 6-month tour on the USS Raleigh with the 2nd Marine Division, 2nd Marine Amphibious Force. However, his favorite assignment was that of a court-martial at the Owasawi Golf Course in Okinawa, Japan. His wife, Gina, is a school teacher in the Franklin Special School District. Mike and Gina have 4 children. Here to speak on the occasion of Veterans Day, as we remember those that have not only sacrificed their lives, but servicemen and women that continue to sacrifice their personal time with family, and certain freedoms as they serve, is Dr. Mike Looney, United States Marine Corps veteran and superintendent of Williamson County Schools.
Good morning. It's a pleasure to be in view. I'm going to spend 3 or 4 minutes talking to you about a couple different things, and before I begin, I just want everybody to very silently, humbly, look at the person to your left, and then right, and to your rear. Without cracking up and laughing, look at them. Odds are, they look different than you do. Odds are that their home life is different than yours. Odds are that they might be the opposite sex or gender. Odds are they might be taller, skinnier, fatter, stronger, faster, have a different belief system than you, go to a different church or synagogue than you do, have more or fewer brothers and siblings than you do, and bring to the table different life experiences. Yet something about them and you bonds you together. You see, I know that because on Friday nights, you show up at the same football field right here in the View and support the same team, and you don't think about the things that make you different. You think about the fact that you're a Yellow Jacket, and that you love your school and your community, and you come together to support one common perspective, one unifying perspective. So you might say, Dr. Looney, well, what does that have to do with Veterans Day? Everything. Absolutely everything. You see, when I was a young Marine, it didn't matter to me whether the person in my foxhole, and by the way, a foxhole was simply a shallow trench that military folks dig to keep from getting shot, to protect themselves. So it didn't matter to me whether the person in my foxhole looked different, talked different, was born in the same state and or country, went to the same type of church, liked rock and roll music or country music, came from a home where both family members, both parents lived, or where it was just a single mom or a single dad. None of that mattered. You see, because we were there for a common purpose, just like you come to school for a common purpose and support your team on Friday night, or you root for the University of Alabama on Saturday. Or UT, I know. Roll Tide. None of that mattered in that foxhole. And young men and women and special guests, we live in an extremely polarizing time in our country. And I can't think of a more appropriate time for us to pause and celebrate those people that have chosen or were drafted to serve, and in some cases gave the ultimate sacrifice. You see, because they did it in spite of our differences, in spite of what people looked like or smelled like or talked like, they did it because they had one thing in common. They loved and love their country. And that's really what Veterans Day is about. You see, we serve because we love. You show up on Friday nights because you love your football team. And I'm trying to put it in a perspective that you can understand. You do it because you care and because you love. And that's why men and women join the armed services and go overseas and do all kinds of things. Fight, cook for one another, take care of one another, wash each other's clothes, take care of the wounded, all the things that happen in the service. You see, because being in the military is much like living in a city or a small town. Everybody does everything together and for one another, despite the fact that we're very different in lots of ways. So every single morning, I presume that you're asked to stand and recite the Pledge of Allegiance, right? So when you do that, young men and women, it's not just because the principal said it. It's not just because it's being said over the loudspeaker. It's an opportunity for you to get together and make a promise to one another, to yourselves, to the community, and to our country. I pledge allegiance to the flag. I pledge, I promise, loyalty and faithfulness to the flag. What's the next part? I pledge my loyalty to the United States of America, even though we're different. Even though there's Yankees and Southerners and East Coasterners and California folks, we're pledging allegiance to one another. We're promising to be faithful and loyal to one another. What's the next? Come on. I pledge allegiance to the flag and to the United States and to the Republic for which it stands. The Republic for which it stands. Yes, we're Tennesseans, but we're an amalgamation of people across multiple states, a republic for which it stands. That we're not pledging loyalty to the flag, we're pledging loyalty to the country, and the flag stands for our country. So you have an option. In fact, you see it on TV these days. People sit down when the Pledge of Allegiance is recited. They don't stand at attention. They don't take their caps off. They tweet, they text, they Instagram, they talk on their cell phone. You know what? Love them anyway, because they're Americans too. What's the next part? One nation under God, indivisible, right? So let's talk about one nation under God. And no matter what our differences are, we can't be divided. We're one nation, one, not two, not 10, not 50, one, under God. Whoever your belief system, whatever church you go to, we serve a higher authority as a country. Indivisible, which means what? We can't be divided. Even when we have differences, we can't be divided. We're still all Americans. We're still all citizens of one nation with liberty and... I want to stop there for a second. With liberty. What's a synonym for liberty? Freedom. With liberty and justice. So we have freedom and justice. Justice. Treating other people fairly. You know, at this great school, the Be Nice Mantra movement, way of life, started. And there are school districts all across the state of Tennessee and beyond that are adopting Be Nice. And this is the birthplace of it. Well, in lots of ways, it reminds me of when we stand up and say the Pledge of Allegiance every day. Because it's about justice for all. The meek, the shy, the quiet, the verbose, the loud, the obnoxious, the disabled, the enabled, the smart ones, the ones that struggle, the African-American ones, the Muslims, the Christians, the non-believers, justice for all. So my plea to you is this. Tomorrow morning, well actually you're not going to say it tomorrow morning unless you're working with me. Monday, when you report back to school, when you stand to say the Pledge of Allegiance, please pause Reflect on the words that you're saying. Otherwise, you're just saying words. Why would you just say words? You're making a promise, not only to yourselves, but to your classmates, to your countrymen, and to the veterans that chose to give their life so that you could have liberty and justice for all. I'm going to close with a story. I loved the Marine Corps. It was absolutely the best experience of my life. And believe it or not, serving the military is not all bad. I landed in Okinawa, Japan, and I was an explosive expert, commonly referred to as a combat engineer in the military. And I landed on Okinawa, it was extremely hot, and the humidity was horrible, and I walked in to report to my commanding officer, and he looked at me and he said, "Sergeant Looney." I said, "Yes, sir." "Do you play golf?" "No, sir, have never even touched a golf ball." "Well, you better learn, son. You're going to the golf course." I was there to blow things up. I was thinking, okay, I gotta blow up some golf courses. No, I had to learn the rules of golf and enforce the rules of golf at this military golf course. Because on military installations, you have stores, you have Burger Kings, you have restaurants, you have basketball gyms, you have softball, you have everything that you have in a regular city. It's just all military folks. So I did that. Well, there was a guy named Jesse who was from, I don't know where he was from anymore, so many moons ago. But anyways, Jesse was one of those guys that was just a little bit different. He would come to work in the morning wearing headphones, and it was connected to an 8-track tape player. And I know that you don't know what that is, but it's an old CD player. That before CDs. Well, Jesse would not interact with us very much, and one of our jobs every morning was to get all the golf carts from the storage shed to the first tee so the customers could get in the golf carts and go. Well, I had to go down this very long, narrow road with the golf carts every morning. And Jesse and a couple of other guys, we would all do that. It was always before it got daylight. So one morning, I was a prankster. So one morning, I decided I was going to scare Jesse. And I hid behind a tree, and here comes Jesse with his headphones on, playing his favorite tunes, leaning back in the golf cart, and he was going down that narrow road. And I jumped out in front of him and said, "Hey!" And I thought he would stop. He didn't. He hit the gas pedal instead. And he veered real sharply to the left. It just so happened that very sharply to the left was this beautiful banana tree. And he slammed straight into it. And his head hit the sidebar of the golf cart. And I went up to him and said, Jesse, I am so sorry. I didn't mean for you to get hurt. I was just playing a trick on you." He said, "Mike, did you see what I saw?" I said, "No, Jesse, what did you see?" He said, "A big bird, it attacked me." I said, "No, Jesse, it was me. It was me. I wasn't the big bird." So I had to go tell my boss, "Hey, Jesse had to go to get some stitches, and by the way, we cracked the golf cart up a little bit." And from that time on, my nickname on the island was Big Bird. So when you see me, you're welcome to call me Big Bird. Have a blessed Veterans Day.
Please turn your attention to the screen as we watch a tribute to veterans prepared by Fairview Middle School.
Thank you. the governor.
I'm your imaginary friend.
I get some, and I'm praying for the video.
And I know.
We're all praying for you.
I'm in your prayers. Oh, I'm already there.
I heard you say you're in my head all the time, and I know you're with me, and the governor's doing his job, and it's the job you love.
FVHS and FMS choir will now sing America the Beautiful. The choir is being co-directed by Ms. Monica Laird and Mrs. Christina Westover. The choir will be led by the FVHS Choir Council Lemon Horn, Shelby Magnum, Rachel Chapman, and Chris Cooper. Ladies and gentlemen, the FVHS and FMS choir. Thank you. First Sergeant Christopher Turk entered military service as indirect fire infantryman on 11th April 1990 at the age of 17. He attended basic training at Fort Jackson, South Carolina, and advanced individual training at Fort Benning, Georgia. In March of 1992, he became a light wheeled vehicle mechanic. First Sergeant Turk has served in a variety of positions, including squad leader, U.S. Army drill instructor, platoon sergeant, Master Fitness Non-Commissioned Officer, Quick Reaction Force Non-Commissioned Officer in Charge, Non-Commissioned Officer in Charge of Ordnance Center and School Educational Systems Quality Assurance Evaluation Office, Airborne Infantry Forward Support Company First Sergeant, Brigade Senior Maintenance Supervisor, Acting Command Sergeant Major for the 2nd Battalion, 503rd of the 173rd Airborne Brigade Combat Team while deployed to Afghanistan, and Senior Military Instructor at John Carroll University. His assignments include 2 assignments at Fort Bragg, North Carolina, with the 35th SIG Brigade Airborne and 321st Airborne Field Artillery Regiment, 82nd Airborne Division, Fort Jackson, South Carolina, Fort Campbell, Kentucky, Aberdeen Proving Grounds, Maryland. His overseas assignments include 3 combat tours, 2 tours in Iraq and 1 tour in Afghanistan, Kunar and Wardak provinces. He also served in Alaska with the 1st Battalion, 501st Parachute Infantry Regiment, and in Vicenza, Italy, with the 173rd Airborne Brigade Combat Team, and 2 Division Battalion Airborne 503rd Division Infantry. His awards and decorations include the Bronze Star Medal, the Meritorious Service Medal, the Army Commendation Medal, Army Achievement Medal, and Good Conduct Medal, Afghanistan Campaign Medal, NATO Medal, Iraqi Campaign Medal, Global War on Terrorism Service Medal, Global War on Terrorism Expeditionary Medal, National Defense Service Medal with Star. First Sergeant Turk retired from the United States Army on 31st May 2013. First Sergeant Turk is currently continuing a career of service as an Army instructor for Fairview High School Junior ROTC. He has a wife, Angelia Turk, a teacher at Charlotte Elementary School in Charlotte, Tennessee, and a 15-year-old son, Nicholas, who attends Fairview High School. The Fairview High School band will play On a Hymn Song of Philip Bliss. The band is being directed by Justin Barr. The choir will be led by Monica Laird.
He just went a little too far. Good morning. All right, so I'm just gonna warn you, I'm an emotional person. Those of you that know me, you know that I get mad, I get angry, I laugh, I cry, so I'm sorry in advance. Because these things really get emotional for me. That's why I really don't like speaking, but I felt this was a good opportunity to get to know the student body and let them get to know me a little bit on a more personal level. First off, I want to say thank you to the band and the choir for participating in this, and the middle school for participating in this. It means a lot to us that you wanted to be involved, and so far your performance has been awesome. Dr. Looney, Dr. Hoyer, Mr. Butler, Ms. Brown, teachers and students of Fairview High School and Fairview Middle School, and veterans, thank you for coming today. I am First Sergeant Retired Christopher Turk. I'm one of the junior Army ROTC instructors here at Fairview High School, and I'm nervous too. Let me begin by saying it is an honor and a privilege for us today to do this. It wasn't my idea to hold this assembly, so I just want to get that off right. It was my cadet's idea. This is all them. Yeah, I helped them plan it and facilitate it, but this is all them. They put a lot of... Thank you for recognizing that. Well, you already gave him the credit, so that's good. I always get choked up these things, and it, you know, the interest they took in this really, it got to me again, because they put so much time and effort into everything they do. I just can't help it. And I'm really grateful for them. They help me every day more than I could ever help them, because they give me the opportunity to give back, and that's healing for me. Today, we celebrate the lives of our veterans, living, past, present, and the fallen, and to remember all of them always. President John F. Kennedy said, "A nation reveals itself not only by the men it produces, but also by the men it honors, the men it remembers." This is a little bit more modified today because a lot of women are on the battlefront as well, not just men. There's many women that are killed in action, wounded in action, combat, lame, maimed, and other things, so they deserve the credit as well. Today we honor and remember American soldiers, sailors, airmen, Marines, and members of the Coast Guard. Ordinary men and women who have answered our nation's call to protect and defend our way of life. Something less than a half of a half of a half of a percent of all Americans. That's all that serves in the military, less than a half of a half of a percent. Veterans Day is a day to honor and say thank you to the men and women that wrote a blank check with a maximum payment of up to their life. To say thank you for their many sacrifices. These were ordinary men and women who rose to meet at times seemingly impossible odds and extraordinary things. These brave men and women left the safety of their homes and towns to defeat terrorists, tyrants, and our enemies, to ensure justice, and to ensure all of us back home were safe. We could sleep peacefully at night because these brave souls put it all on the line. They fulfilled a promise, an oath, to ensure the safety and security for our citizens and the world. You know, these people that joined the military, they're not much different than anyone here. Their brothers, their sisters, their fathers, their mothers, their sons, their daughters. Nobody goes into the military expecting to go to war. I mean, you would think that goes with the territory, but you don't think like that as a kid. When I joined the military, I wasn't thinking of that. For me, I escaped a bad life. I had a really bad childhood. I was not the greatest kid, but that's why I joined, because I just wanted a better life. And as I got in, I swore I wouldn't do two things, and that was re-enlist and get married. And I did both within a month. I don't normally tell stories, and I'm kind of going off my speech here, but you know, watching the video, it kind of chokes me up. And I don't want Dr. Looney to show me up either, so. I have the honor and privilege to serve along a lot of great warriors. I personally know and serve with three Medal of Honor winners. I personally serve with men that were so courageous, that did such courageous things without even thinking about themselves or anybody else, that blindly go into a hail of gunfire to get their buddy back that the enemy took because they knew what was going to happen. I've had the privilege to know a lot of soldiers didn't come home. And it's not a privilege, but it was a privilege to know them. You know, sometimes I get called a hero. I'm not a hero. I've never been and never will be. Those guys that didn't come home, those men and women that didn't come home, they're the heroes. They're the ones that represent our country and our way of life. They give everything of themselves. Those are the heroes. Today we remember our veterans, past and present, our fallen. We also remember the families. The families of the missing, wounded, and the Gold Star families who lost loved ones while serving. You know, that's probably the hardest thing that affects me was my relationship with my son, or the lack thereof. You know, I was stationed in Vicenza, Italy, and everybody's like, oh, that must have been great. But I really only spent a year there. 3 years, and I was gone most of the time. If I wasn't in Germany doing training or in some other place in Italy doing training, I was in Afghanistan. And then I was a first sergeant, so I wasn't home even when I was home. I spent many nights at the MP station. The only regret I have is with my son. But the good thing is I'm here, and we get to build our relationship one day at a time. And it's amazing, and I see him growing into a great young man. And I guess that's a little personal for me, but I felt it was important to share it. We also have families here today that have lost loved ones due to injuries in combat. They succumbed to the wounds. And I really appreciate your sacrifice, because family sacrifice just as much as the soldiers do. They always do. While we're at war, they're at home waiting. You know, in the 173rd, every time somebody got killed, they sent what was called a red line message to the families. All communications cut off, and all they get is this message that says somebody was killed. And, you know, that they don't know who it is or anything until the family's notified. So every time one of those red line messages came out, every single family member in our brigade was on their edge because they didn't know if it was their level. I was really guilty not calling home a lot. And the reason I didn't call home, because it was really selfish. It was too hard for me to call home. I'm sorry, I lost my train of thought. I ask that you remember our service members still missing in action, the ones that we can't find. Our nation is very committed to the warrior ethos, so I will never leave a fallen comrade, and continue its efforts to locate, identify, and repatriate those men and women who have not returned home. Over the years, many people have thanked me for my service to my country, and honestly, I really don't know how to react to that still to this day. I know it's a gracious thing, but for me, I'm just doing my job. So when I kind of give you an awkward look, it's not personal, it's just me. Let this Veterans Day be a beginning of rebirth, of a commitment to live and serve the passion, joy, and enthusiasm. Let us start summer, or let us start the rest of the year with a triumphant and joyous song as we celebrate liberty, love, and life. To all the veterans in the audience, I'd like to say thank you. Thank you for your sacrifices that the common citizen will never understand. Thank you, and God bless.
Special guest narrator Alex Stenson. Ladies and gentlemen, the Fairview Music Program.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, please direct your attention to the table in front of you. We ask that you remain seated, yet silent, as we conduct the POW, MIA, KIA, and WIA ceremony. This ceremony is rich with military tradition as we honor those men and women of our armed forces who, in defense of the freedoms of our country and that of the free world, are unaccounted for and are classified as prisoners of war, missing in action, and killed in action. At all military functions where meals are served, these heroes are always honored and remembered. This table is set for our prisoners of war, those missing in action, and those killed in action, from all wars. The table is set for five, one for each of the armed services. They are not with us this evening.
The table!
The table is round to show that our concern for them is never ending.
The cloth!
The tablecloth is white, symbolizing the purity of their intentions, to respond to their country's call to arms, so that their children could remain free.
Remember!
Let us remember the men and women, prisoners of war from all branches of service that are too often forgotten. Let us remember them.
The candle!
The lone yellow candle symbolizes the frailty of a prisoner alone, trying to stand up against his oppressors.
The ribbon!
The yellow ribbon on the candle reminds us of those who will not be coming home. The single red rose reminds us of the loved ones and families of our comrades in arms who keep the faith and await their return.
The red ribbon!
The red ribbon on the rose represents the love of our country, which inspired them to answer the nation's call.
The napkin!
The black napkin stands for the emptiness these warriors have left in the hearts of their family and friends. A slice of lemon is on the bread plate to remind us of their bitter fate if we do not bring them home.
The salt!
There is salt on the plate, symbolic of the family's tears as they wait and remember.
The glass!
The glass is inverted, reminding us that our distinguished comrades cannot be with us, maybe tomorrow, if we remember. The pictures on the wall are a reminder that they are missed very much and are remembered by their families.
The flag!
The flags are posted to mourn the fact that many of our comrades will not return to our shores and to pay tribute to their passing. As we look upon this empty table, do not remember ghosts from the past, but remember our comrades. The empty chairs depict an unknown face representing no specific soldier, sailor, airman, marine, or Coast Guardsman, but all are here with us this evening.
Remember!
Remember those whom we depended on in battle. They depend on us to remember their sacrifice.
Remember!
Remember our friends. They are the ones we love, who love life and freedom as we do. They will remember what we do. Please honor and remember them. Remember them always. Remember.
Center. Face.
Thank you.
Please join us as our battalion chaplain. Cadet Sergeant First Class A.J. Garcia leads us in the invocation.
Please pray with me. Dear Lord, thank you once again for allowing us to come together today. Thank you for the freedom that these servicemen and women have given to us, God. We pray that you protect and watch over our servicemen and women as they continue to fight in faraway lands, far away from their families. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Ladies and gentlemen, this concludes our salute to veterans. Thank you for attending today's ceremony. Please feel free to view the salute to veterans wall on your way out. We wish you a good day. Thank you.